Okay, good. The battery light hasn't come on. That's a good sign. Yeah, about that. I think the charge circuit in my camcorder is beginning to die on me. It's no longer making a solid connection with the charge cable. Yeah, that just came back on. There we go. Time for the dollar store mega special, requested personally by a little friend by the name of Misani. So, let's jump right into it. Basically, I went to Dollar Tree, and frankly, I went a lot overkill. So our first item is squeegee. Our second item, for a dollar, you can get a hold of a frog bubble maker. Or a hippo one. I got both. You can tell by the way I got both. I'm gonna move the camera so we can see it better. Hang on. There we go. Now I can see more of the incredibly messy workbench. This is the hippo and frog bubble maker. This one's packaging is kind of getting like ripples on it for some reason, if you can see that. Maybe a little bit. Yeah. These are bubble makers. And the bubble fluid that Dollar Tree recommended, or should I say just happened to be next to them on the shelf, is this. Generic bubbles. Just bubbles. That's all you get. I think I also got a different kind as well that was sort of on the next shelf over. Yeah, here we go. Bubble Fun, fresh fruit scented. This one is apparently pink flavor. As a fellow Big Clive fan, I have to pick the pink one. What's it smell like, first off? I'm gonna guess artificial strawberry. Oh, geez, yeah, it's an artificial strawberry smell that's so strong it basically burns your nose. Now, first things first, let's just give it a try as is. It's half decent. It makes bubbles. The child within gives this a seal of approval. I also bought some batteries for them because super heavy duty. That's my inner smash stuff 30 coming out. Now, which one should we do first? The hippo or the frog? I'm assuming they have the same guts, just different cases. Let's do the frog one. It's also going to be the one I will tear apart to see what makes it work. So, let's open it up. Here is the frog bubble maker, and that's it. Nothing in the box, not even instructions. Oh, yeah, there are the instructions. Yeah. Bubbles and B requires 3 AA. I'm guessing that's just the batteries. Here we go. Bubbles and batteries are not included. Wait, it takes AAAs? Oh, I only bought AAs. Hang on. I found some AAAs. Yeah, I don't like it when things with a motor run on AAA batteries because it just drains them. And this one says they're for low drain devices. And a motor is, I would classify anything with a motor in it as high drain personally. So, yeah, for the record, these are also batteries from the dollar store. I just keep a decent stock of them for these kinds of videos. But I'm not buying good quality batteries for a piece of junk I'll probably use once and then blow to pieces. Oh, it's got a screw in it. I hate it when they do that. Give me a second. Again! Luckily, I came prepared with my deluxe Harbor Freight piece of junk screwdriver set. Well, the screw already came stripped from the factory. I don't know if you can see that or not, but it's all rounded out in there. Not sure if you can see that or not. This camera doesn't have a very good screen. Let's try the next size up, see if that helps. A Phillips 1. It still doesn't work. Okay, fine, bubble maker, be that way. There we go. That got into it. Okay, let's turn it on. Well, it runs. And that little dinky fan does move a bit of air. Although I can definitely hear the motor beginning to slow down a little bit just from the load on it. Fill it right up to the top, give it the best possible chance. There we go. Now let's see if it's any good or not. Let's see if we can make the bubbles. Oh, it does! It doesn't do that bad a job, actually. See if I can take the camera. I'm gonna move the camera down a bit. Yeah, it's not too bad, actually. Oh, I could definitely hear the motor slowing down from those crappy batteries, though. Yeah. That's not that bad. For a dollar, you can't really okay, fine. $2 if you count the bubble liquid. Yeah, for a dollar, you can't really complain. I'm gonna keep that running up here till the battery dies. Just pumping spurts of bubbles all over the workbench. Yeah, that motor is really slowing down. Let's see, what else do we have? Next on the pile is an oral care kit. It comes with a plastic mirror with a knife on the end of it. Comes with a couple of picks and whatever this contraption is, and a little toothbrush. So what is it anyway? Also, by the way, for the record, that does not smell like strawberries. It's beginning to smell like burning electric motor. I think 4.5 volts might be a bit much for the little motor in this thing. It comes with a toothbrush, a tongue cleaner, a dental mirror, and a dental aid. Tongue cleaner? That's what that is? That's a tongue cleaner? That really is beginning to smell bad. I'm gonna keep going till the motor burns up. Okay, so going in reverse order, toothbrush, tongue cleaner, dental mirror, dental aid. Why don't they call it like a pick or something? Oh, I forgot about this. The soft battery-powered toothbrush from Dollar Tree. Battery included, massages and stimulates gums, cleans between teeth and vibrating motion. I'm gonna turn this off. It's starting to get quite irritating and getting... Yeah, it's gotten soap bubbles all over my workbench and my tools and stuff. That's always great. Yeah, you'll see in a minute why I think they've just reused the mold from something else. Get it open here. If I can get it. Oh, there's a pull tab on the back. Clean the battery contacts prior to battery installation. I guess that means that, yeah, clean the contacts. That means that they don't clean it themselves at the factory. It's just made of rust and mold. Or probably just lots of chinesium. Where's the power button? Doesn't click. Oh, it's on the bottom. Okay. So, just set that on the completely sanitary workbench and look at this battery that seems to have already begun to leak a little bit in the package. Wipe that off. Super heavy duty zinc chloride. That means it'll leak as soon as it gets depleted. Doesn't have a brand on it though. Just is made in China. Super heavy duty. Let's plug it in and see what it does. There's a little motor in there. Now this is beginning to look suspiciously like a certain item that Big Clive reviewed. And I think you'll see why in just a moment. Yeah, it's because it does this. Okay, because it doesn't do that. It doesn't work. Turn on. Is the battery dead? Turn on. Oh, lovely. It doesn't actually work out of the box. That's embarrassing. Let's try a different battery. I'm glad I bought these double A's now. Maybe this is why I gotta clean the contacts. Is it seated right? Did I put it in the wrong way, maybe? Turn it. On. I think I've broken it. Where's that connection go? It's just like a friction fit. Why isn't that working? Give me a second here, guys. I'm gonna see if I can figure this out. Okay, I've got a brand new dollar store battery, and we're gonna see if it works. And if it doesn't work, then I'm just gonna blow it to pieces. Well, to be fair, I did warn you. Anyway, well, there's this metal contact. I guess that's something, right? Next item. This is a little push light. It's interesting because the previous design of this, it's been redesigned. Yeah, new and improved, 80 lumens. Normally the original design had 3 LEDs. Now it looks like it's a chip on board. So, that's very interesting to me. I'm running out of batteries. That's not good. Probably shouldn't look at it in case it lasers my eyes out with death. So it's got some LEDs, and we're going to see if we can blow up the camera. Oh, geez, that is super bright. Wow, I'm stunned the exposure can go down that low. Yeah, it is definitely extremely bright. Let me shut the lights off. Got an extremely, yeah, I can see it a little bit there. It's got an extremely, like, a really wide beam. Like, you can kind of see it. There it is. It's right there. You can see the lens flare, and then it goes. It's got a very wide beam. Put the lights on. It would definitely be quite good for lighting something. And you just heard my phone turn on there because it was plugged into the charger. Ah, here we go. This looks interesting. A truck woodcraft kit for $1. One kit. See back for contents. Easy to assemble. Contains everything you need, plus instructions. I'm going to put these together later and either upload it in a separate video or attach it to this one at the very end. I'm going to put these over to the side for now because I bought another one as well. And you'll see that at the next part of the video. A 10-foot tape measure with a carabiner clip for $1 from our friends at Tool Bench. And it looks like it's sort of been taped over, so this is probably a broken one. I just realized that now, actually. In the glare there. 10 feet it advertises. Tape measure with carabiner. Yes, we know what it is. Try me! Oh, it's one of these horrible... It's like one of these sheet metal ones. It's basically just a spring that's been unwound. And it won't open. What the heck? Who designed this packaging and why have they been allowed to live? I did not prepare for this. Hang on. Oh, it has a little locking switch. I didn't notice that. Does it work? Not really. No. The locking switch does not work. Let's see how it compares to a proper tape measure if I can find it. Here we go. This is the one I use out here, a Milwaukee one. The locking thing, for one, actually works. And then you can compare the thickness, although there's not really any contest. Yeah. I guess the scale's all right, though. I mean, they line up over 10 inches. Let's see how far it'll go out. Let's see if the scale stays accurate. There's 4 feet. Oh, yeah, look at that. Accurate all the way to 76 inches. It's right on the dot. If my camera will... There we go. It's accurate right out to 76 inches on the dot. So at least it's labeled accurately. If we pull it out to more than 10 feet, does it break? Yeah, that goes out to exactly 10 feet and then it stops. It's got a red mark. Oh, and it broke. That was the spring unwinding. Well, now I have a 10-foot long... infinitely sharp cutting blade that makes amusing noises. Next up is a spray nozzle for cleaning my truck at work because, frankly, well, the company I work for doesn't actually have one of these, and I don't like using the hose end, so I bought one of these for $1. It's rattly. That's great. Don't you just love loose parts inside of your watering appliance? Extra squeaky, too. This little fan uses 2 AA batteries. It's a little fan. It's yellow. And I hate the color yellow. So you'll probably guess what is eventually going to happen to this. 2 AA batteries, and there's the motor inside. Just the guts of the motor hanging out in the breeze. Because it's a fan. It's a very cheap, clicky little motor. But it moves the air an okay amount. It's one of those really cheap, extra clicky motors, though. But you know what? I'm not satisfied with its speed. Let's see if we can't make it go a bit faster. Let's make some modifications. Oh, it's blowing the wrong way. Hang on, let me reverse it. There we go. Let's get a bit closer to it. Hear it better. So I'd reckon this is at about 10 volts. Let's crank it up, see how fast we can make it go. Aww! The wire came off! Made the smoke though. Yeah, the wire fell off. We're connected a little better, so let's get right back to it. And we're getting nothing. 50 volts, no current.
They just gotta push it.
Oh, there we go. Made a zap. It's not working. Why isn't it going? Oh, I broke it. No! Oh, it turned there. A little bit, maybe. Maybe. No, I think I broke it. Okay, well, let's see what happened to that motor, because it was clearly defective. I mean, a little 1-volt motor can work on 50 volts, no problem. Now let's open it up here. The little tabs you just unscrew or whatever. See what was so defective about the motor that it refused to work, even at like 20 volts. I mean, more voltage means it goes faster, right? Yeah, the winding's melted. See it right there near the star. The insulation burnt off. How's that supposed to work? Oh, geez. It's only half of a motor inside. I was not expecting that. Wow. That's amazing. Normally the laminations go up to this bushing, but no, it's just half of a motor. That must be how they keep the prices so low. They're literally only giving you half of a motor. I guess that's why it blew up so fast, too. I'll save this fan for something else.
Next.
Food. I had a feeling you would get a kick out of this, Masani. The tuna salad. Brunswick tuna salad with crackers ready to eat. Serving suggestion. It comes with crackers. Sounds like it comes with a little spoon, too. Now, let's give it a try. Ingredients, crackers, tuna salad. It comes with tuna, celery, textured soy flour, sugar, carrots. Whatever this is, some horrible chemical. Gluconodelta, lactone, and onion. So let's give it a try, see how great it is on the sanitary food surface of the workbench with bits of plastic. Oh, it does come with a little spoon. But yeah, it's got a nice shape to it. To be honest, you could probably use it as a magnifying glass to burn something. But I'm not going to do that, I'm just going to eat it. Oh jeez, I sure hope that's not like mold or something in there. Oh no, it'll be fresh. Actually, what is the expiration date on this? All I get is like some kind of weird manufacturing code. Well, let's give it a try anyway. Hopefully it won't kill me. Try some. Yummy. Delicious. Whoa. That's like tuna salad, but with like extra pickle. Is there pickle in it? Mayonnaise, celery, water chestnuts, vegetable broth. Yeah, there's no mention of pickles in it unless that's in the broth, but I'm tasting pickles. Maybe it's like pickled celery. I don't know. Oh, it fell on the workbench. Just eat it right off of there. Those chunks in it. Yummy. No, okay, fine, I'll put it in the trash. Yummy. I'm not a huge fan of tuna salad, but it's okay. Oh good, I can like scoop it out on the cracker. That's pretty good. I think I sent you a message about this earlier, Masani. You know what people need more in their lives? An inflatable parrot. And yeah, it's an inflatable parrot that smells like spray paint. I'm guessing that's just an incredibly cheap vinyl. Yeah, it's a large inflatable parrot. You know what? Let's inflate it. Okay, I've gone ahead and spun the camera around. I've got the door open because it's quite a nice day. There's the Variac down there. And here is the dollar store inflatable parrot. I've got my portable air tank here that I'll use to fill it with. We'll see what 100 PSI or so will do to an inflatable parrot. Oh, it fell right off. Why'd it do that? It's supposed to be the best inflatable parrot ever in the world. Or the only one, I guess. Stuff it right on. There we go. Inflatable parrot, go! There we go. And ta-da! I have an inflatable parrot. It's about, it's about as long as my arm. Up to the shoulder there. And it's got its brand stamped right on the back of it, and I can't see because the viewfinder's all messed up. There we go. It really does smell like cheap vinyl and spray paint. They couldn't have possibly used, like, a spray paint on it, could they? I don't know. I'll put it here on the Variac. Hopefully it's puncture-resistant, because there's all kinds of crud there. Next up, we have... just some squirt guns. Squirt guns, for whatever reason, have always been a nostalgic thing to me at Easter time. Back when I used to get gift baskets, they would always have a squirt gun in them. These things are usually notoriously low quality. This one doesn't even properly fit in my hand. I guess it sort of works. The pump moves air, but not much else. The real thing is, I was impressed by how brittle the plastic is. Well, this one's not too bad. Usually they have a really hard time sealing them, and they tend to leak a little bit. I didn't bring any water out here. I'll test those in a little while. It's an air horn. Avertisseur Pneumatic. It's a pneumatic advertiser, I guess. This video is sponsored by air in general. A little handle. Ow! That is painful. Let's overload the camera's microphone. Yeah, that's painful. The main reason I wanted to get this was so I could hook it up to my air compressor and just overload it and see if it would explode or not. Because it looks kind of like it'll fit a 1/8 inch pipe thread. Let me see, what do I have in the way? Do I have any 1/8 inch pipe thread? Nah, it's not 1/8. Prepare your ear holes. I don't even know what noise that was trying to make. Yeah, I think I blew it up. I'm gonna stop that now before I legitimately damage my hearing. That's really bad. I'm not surprised if that actually peaked on the camera's microphone. But yeah, that definitely works. So I broke that, and I also broke my ears! So that is a bonus feature of this video. Next item. Next item is a bag of gummy bears. It'll have some of these gummy bears. They're a proper brand. Not the best brand ever, but they're gummy bears, okay? They're okay. Have a red one. Ugh. They're all real sticky, like they've been... sitting on the shelf for a while, they're all, like, sticky. That's great. Six new flavors, huh? Blue raspberry, grape, cherry, orange. There's not new flavors. And the cherry one tastes like cough syrup. Okay, fine. Not all gummy bears are created equal. Those ones aren't very good. Great, now I have to talk with my mouth full of stuff. Next. Don't mind me just choking to death. There we go. by Turbo Wheels. Flip over car. Requires two AAA batteries. Man, I'm gonna run out of this by the time the video is over. Well, it's a little toy car. Looks like a shark. Now it's got four-wheel drive, so I guess that's interesting. Oh, look, if you spin the motor, the lights turn on. The circuitry is that bad inside of it. Here we go. Let's turn it on. Well, the gearbox is a bit crusty. Oh, look at that. It's like the way it spins with the camera's refresh rate. That's kind of cool. Now, let's see. What does this thing actually do? Basically, how this thing works is trying not to break the charge cord to my camera. Basically, what you would do is it's got like a thingy on it that flips. So what you would do is you would just set it down and it sort of climbs over stuff. And then it sort of flips itself back over if it falls. Except here, because there's something in the way. There we go. Kinda, maybe. Jeez, it really likes my measuring tape there. I should probably censor that before the video gets flagged or something. Oh, it fell over. Oh crap, it's still going. Shoot, where'd it go? Oh good, it got stuck. Oh, no, it's still going over there. Yeah, it's stuck down there. Chug-a-train car, I guess we'll call it. Let's turn that off before it actually goes somewhere it should be and knocks over something. There's a switch. Now, you know what? I have plans for this thing. Let's use it to test out a little new gadget I've come up with. Now, I've had to move the camera a bit farther back because the device I'm about to bring up is a little bit large. This is... Trying to lift it. Ooh, it's heavy. Okay. Basically... If the Variac is an electrical stress tester, then this is my mechanical stress tester. This is a treadmill motor. Basically, it is a really big DC motor with tons of speed and tons of torque, and I've spray painted it, and I'm about to ruin the finish by seeing how fast this thing can actually spin this thing until it blows up. Yeah, basically speaking, this thing is unstoppable. Running it full tilt, it goes about this fast. So yeah, this thing is my unstoppable force. So we're gonna put it in the way of something weak and see what it does. We'll just have it idle away at 40 volts. It's currently sucking about 3 amps. And we're gonna see what it'll do to this stupid little toy car thing, if I can figure out where I put it. Hang on. It survived! Oh, there we go. Now it's just... Yeah, there we go. It chewed the heck out of it. Let's throttle this thing up all the way. Yeah, the motor's going now, but there's no longer any sort of connection to the wheels. Let's floor this thing and see what it does. Well, that was quite impressive. Yeah, when you're dealing with those kinds of speeds, it actually, like, melted the tires off. Yeah, that was insane. I'm not even sure if that was on video, but then I put it on here and it actually burned through the plastic and started cutting into the battery. The motor still works and it still kind of turns, but there's no torque at all. And now I've ruined the lovely matte black finish on this thing with the white plastic all over it, so that's great. There's its first scar of war, I suppose. Uh-oh, they're after me. They figured out what I'm doing, and they're trying to come and stop me now. I can hear the police siren. Oh, geez, they are really close. Oh, they just turned the sirens off for some reason. Okay. Oh my goodness. That. It burned out the motor. Look, it burned the bearing out of the motor. Does it still work? Somehow that's still able to work. I've never seen a motor do that and still be able to work somehow. That's insane. Oh, jeez. Oh! Stupid piece of junk alligator clips aren't working. That one's about to break. Oh, that was it? Really? That was it, huh? Just a bit of smoke and then it blew up. Okay, fine. Be that way then, I guess. This one is almost a full motor. Normally the windings will go all the way up to this bushing. This one has a little more. And then the last one, you can definitely tell the difference in that little fan. You could definitely tell the difference in the laminations. So this one's half a motor, this one's about two-thirds of a motor. So, make of that what you will. That really is incredible stuff. How they just optimized down to a price, even in the electric motors in these things, as if they weren't cheap enough. Throw out the battery compartment because it blew up. Let's move the camera back here. There we go. Alright, our next item on the increasingly cluttered workbench is... scented beads. They have a little, I have a little USB fan that takes these and I like them a lot. They're basically those little sort of polymer things, they're like squidgy. They're full of scented liquid, and if you squeeze them too much, they ping off at things. Scented wax melts! Now, the next items are a bit more upscale. There's a place called Five Below, right next to the dollar store. It's the same concept, except everything is $5 or less. And they always have something vaguely interesting in their electronics section. Like, for example... inductive car! Easy to operate, draw your own track, infinite imagination. How does it work? Marker pen not included. Oh, you jerks. Requires button cell batteries. Oh, but they're included, so that's fine. I was about to say, if it requires button cells and they're not included, those freaking mega jerks. A successful line track is not under 5 millimeters, not over 10 millimeters, has no sharp angled turns. A successful line track has no sharp angled turns. Awesome. Uh-oh. Oh, well, the batteries have fallen out. That's not good. The batteries fell out in the box. How's that gonna work? How does it even come out? It's really mashed up in there. Okay. Yeah, the battery just fell out. That's always great. Here's a battery. Here is another battery. Here is the car itself, which is frankly really quite small. And the other two batteries appear to be missing in action. Shoot, where are they? Here's one more. Oh, yep, there they are. Instructions. Oh, I dropped another battery, dang it. The battery compartment's gonna have a screw in it now, isn't it? Yep, I knew it. There it is. It's got a freaking screw in it. Hang on. Oh, and it's not a captive screw either, so that means basically... Wow, that focuses nicely. So basically, if you drop this screw, this battery compartment has no other way to hold itself closed. So if you drop that screw, you are, out of luck. It has two separate compartments. I thought it would be four across, but I guess, two drive the sensor and two drive the motor? Oh! It's two separate motors. That makes sense. I guess to turn left and right or whatever. Ah, I dropped it again! Now the battery cover won't close. There we go. Now let's put the little screw back in. Now, how am I gonna test this? I don't have a smooth white surface to drive on. Let's turn it on and see what it does first. Well, for one, it looks like these front wheels are actually fake. It looks like it uses this thing because it'll glide along the paper easier. And it has two motors. You turn it on. Okay, that's cool. Look at that. They're infrared. I personally cannot see this light. The camera, however, can, because this camera can pick up infrared. So these are infrared sensors. If I cover this one, the other wheel should come on. Yeah, there we go. Sorta. Here we go. This wheel's not mounted very well, though. This looks quite interesting. I've seen larger versions of this in the past. Lights up, 360 stunt rotation, double-sided flip function, rumble and tumble. It's one of these things. I've seen the full-size version of these, but never a miniaturized one. It looks like it's got some lights inside it as well. I don't see any obvious LEDs. Requires two AA batteries. Warning, this product is only used in the 5.0 output device Oh, it's USB charged. That means I'm going to need to charge it first. Product contains one Whiplash RC. That must have been what the original one was called that they ripped off of. When charging, must let the switch in the off state. Banned in don't clean the ground to prevent inhalation of debris. I'm gently dying. Give me a second. It comes with one of these generic USB charging cords, which, if I open it up, will probably contain a small chip to inject malware into whatever computer you're using it with. And it needs two AA batteries, which I conveniently have to, again, remove a screw for. Is that some kind of new standard that every toy has to have screws in it so the kids don't eat the batteries? If so, then I really am ashamed with how far America's sunk. It's not even like four-wheel drive. It's just the back wheel turns. This one just freewheels. Only this one turns the motor. Two micro-sized motors in there, in the front there. Let's put batteries in and see if it comes with a factory charge. If not, I'm gonna have to let this recharge. This one has an extra clip to hold the battery compartment closed, so screw the screw. Oh, it's one of those ones that automatically turns on when you press a button. Oh, it's got those disgusting, just generic colored... Oh, I hate those. Let's see what it does. Oh, it fell. Hard to drive this thing on the workbench. Let's see if we can get it to spin around and do the thing. Fell again.
Last but not least, we finally have what I think is probably the most amusing of all of these devices.
The pile driver. Remote controlled, three function, highly advanced, poop with fart sound button. It's an RC turd. Wanna have a poop race? You will need two different remote channels. Purchase the 27 and 49 megahertz poop and let the race begin. Number two toy in the world, huh? How come I've never seen it until literally today? Oh, it shows how advanced it is. Polyvinyl material for realistic feel and action. Audio system for dispersing realistic fart sounds. Technical specifications, sort of. sophisticated gearbox allowing 360 spins, so it can only spin around 360 times before it blows up. The pile driver emblem indicates authenticity. This is the original real deal. That's not a trademark, it's just a speck of dirt. Advanced engineering for optimal aerodynamics. Plunger joystick. Forward propels pile driver forward. Back sends pile driver into a swirly spin. Fart deployment button. Awesome. And then there's the generic technical specifications that it takes two AA batteries and then two button cells, which had better be included. Okay, good. The button cells are included, but the AAA batteries are not included. Oh, wait, shoot, I don't have any AAAs left. What the? Well, crap. Oh my goodness, that is adorable. It actually has a little remote with a proper retractable antenna, forward and backward, and then the giant fart deployment button. Now, I do like this just for the remote. This is like a remote I love. Now then, let's see. Let's get the screw open, which I don't love. I hate it when they put screws on battery compartments. I hate it, hate it, hate it. Is it really that much more expensive to put a shoulder on your threads to make it a captive screw, you jerks? Now, mind the pun, but this is a bit of a crappy move. If you look, after you peel off the FCC warning sticker that I guess has to be on every single radio-controlled item in America, if you look, the giant fart speaker, this is all the battery compartment. There's nothing there. It's only these three holes. Let's turn it on. Does it make a noise? No. Does it work? The motor spins. I like that a lot. Okay, maybe I don't like that part that much. I guess it just can't get a good grip on the workbench. Oh, don't fall. Let's do the giant fart button. I quite like that, though. I'm sure it'll make a good dog toy, at least. Okay, you know what? There's one last item before I go into the bonus features, and that is the epic fart whistle! Bigger and better for louder farts. Make poop music. Now, the reason I got this is, well, kind of like the air horn, so I could hook it up to the air compressor and see how big of a fart I could actually make with it. A bit of rubber connected to a plastic mouthpiece. Doesn't work. Really? Doesn't really sound like a fart. It sounds more like a duck that's dying. Well, maybe it'll sound better once it's hooked up to 100 PSI. Yeah, that doesn't really work. It just makes a honking noise instead of a fart noise. I don't know why. There's no instructions, though. I guess it just doesn't work. Not even with... It works a little better if you kind of put your finger on it. Okay, that works a little better. You can't just blow through it. You kind of gotta put your finger on it. But yeah, it's just a... Just a piece of silicone with a hole at the end, and it's the end of a whoopee cushion. So yeah, that would be it. Except it isn't! You may in fact be wondering right now why there is now a small stainless steel fork next to the poop. Well, it's because I did actually buy some more food. Let's see what we got. I bought a couple more food items. these Vienna Bites, and, as if it couldn't get any worse, dollar store spam. So let's give them a try. Move the camera up a little bit more and see all the deliciousness. Okay, let's start with this. Ugh, there's water inside it. Yummy. The lunch of, I guess, college students, which I used to be. Throw that in the garbage there. Let's try some. Well, it's not really exciting. It's, well, it's a bit of, it's like raw hot dogs floating in salt water. Because it's pretty much literally what they are. Don't they look so delicious? It's on my hand. No, I dripped my hand water back into there. That's great. I'll finish those later. On to our next delight. Bristol classic luncheon loaf. Made with chicken, ham, and baked ham seasoning with smoke flavor added. Fitting lifestyle. Oh, hang on. Wait, didn't Ashens do a video about this? I think he did, actually. Hang on, I'll link the video in. Let's try some. Put the fork over there. Oh, that looks slightly less appetizing. That's, I don't know what to make of that. You can see the impression where the lid of the can was. That's always great. Yeah, it looks about the same shade of horrible, what's that word, anemic pink that you would expect, and it looks about the same on the camera. Let's try some. Oh, jeez. I don't know what to make of that. It's quite, well, I don't know. I've had Spam before, and this tastes like Spam, except somehow even cheaper. Wow, serving size 2 ounces, servings per container 6. And that's, yeah. So, just by eating this one thing, I'm apparently having 120% my daily recommended dose of salt if I eat this whole thing. Which, to be honest, I probably will, because I'm quite hungry. Okay, I'm not going to stand here and have you watch me eat this whole thing. Especially because it's mostly out of frame. Let's move on to the RC things. Okay, well, the camera's outside now, pointing at a more level part of the garage floor. Give me a second, let me get these RC things. Okay, I've got them now. So let's start off with the, start off with this one. So we'll turn it on, bask in the quality of its really crappy RGB LED lights. Oh geez, it's pretty fast. There's quite a bit of a delay in the commands. Like I press a button, you'll see it react. And it's already out of range. Are you kidding me right now? It can't even go that far. It can't even go that far. Wow, that's pretty miserable, actually. Yeah. Doesn't even look like it does the thing where it, like, opens up. Hang on, let me get more frame here. Yeah, I think the issue is one of these motors turns way faster than the other.
And as a result, it can't really drive in a straight line. And the remote control is so unreliable, you can't really get it to turn either. There's basically no way to get it to go in a straight line. And now it's underneath the lawnmower and I don't know how to get it out. Right there, that was just going in full speed backwards. And you can see it just kept spinning around. It couldn't even go in a straight line. That's pretty miserable. Let's get it out from under the lawnmower. Yeah, unfortunately, I don't recommend this thing.
Okay, the last thing on our list is these wood shop items. There appear to be two different brands. This one says wood shop, and this one is Crafter's Square, even though the logo is in a circle and it involves circles. Let's do the birdhouse first. We get some wood, a piece of string, and what looks like a tiny bottle of glue. So let's see what we got then. Step 1, glue the fence pieces to the outer edge of the base. Make sure to position the short and long fences correctly as shown. Glue the roof pieces onto the flat edge at the top of the part. Glue the post to the center of the base as shown and let dry completely. Push the eyelet firmly into the center and screw the thread feed. Okay. Seems simple enough. For a second there, I thought that said toilet. But no, it's toit. It's French or something. So, what's our first step? Glue the fence pieces to the outer edge of the base. Make sure to position the short and long fences. Okay. Well, it doesn't break from me doing that. I guess that's something. There's the string. These are just like balsa wood or something. Are they all different lengths? No, they say all this stuff about worrying about... Oh, jeez. Wow, that's really small. I almost lost that. That's the piece you hang it with. Now it's got its brand all over it again. Glue the pieces together with their ridiculous cutting, what's it called? Flashing or something? Let's see. How does this work? It says just glue the pieces. That's it. Those are the roof parts. Glue the long and short edges. But it's a square. It's completely square. It's the same on all four sides. About 2 3/4. 2 3/4. 2 3/4. 2 3/4. It's the same. What the heck? Okay, I guess it still applies. Wow, this is so low quality. Oh, the pieces are actually like too long? Like 1/4 inch too long. That would never work. They're 1/4 inch too long on every side. So that just wouldn't work at all. I don't get it. Jeez, I'm glad I bought this. This is a total piece of junk. Comes with a little bottle of glue, though, I guess. The only instructions that they gave me were glue the pieces together. So, guessing this is some kind of like contact cement. It kind of holds. Okay, so they won't, like, just completely fall apart on you. That's decent. Some sort of contact cement or something. Let's put some on this end, too. Nah, let's put some more glue on this end, too, I guess. Now, this just smells like basic, generic, sort of Elmer's glue. So that's probably what... They're probably using Elmer's glue in, like, an unlabeled bottle to, like, avoid licensing restrictions or something.
Put some more glue on it.
Good dab of glue on there. And just sit it there like that. Oh, it's actually kind of holding its own. Wow, look at that. This glue has just enough tack to it to actually work. That's impressive. Come on, hold in place. It actually held in place. a little bit unbalanced, but you know what? I think that's actually gonna work. I am stunned. It's a little bit cockeyed, but maybe that's just because the glue's not setting right. And there we go. I think that might actually work. I'll have to check up on it again tomorrow and make an update video. Oh, that's right. I still need that little eyelet screw in there. I'll drop that in there so I don't forget it. That actually worked. That's impressive. Make a birdhouse for a dollar. But can we make a truck for a dollar? Let's see. Oh, this one actually has the tear hole at the bottom so it can come apart easier. Oh, shoot, there's pieces falling everywhere. It's got its brand on it, and it's the TSCA Title IV compliant, apparently. It's got the same bottle of glue as the other one, so they must be made by the same company. Let's see, how does this work? So it's got some wheels. Ooh, this one actually has like a center point marked on it. That's kind of neat. Let's see if we can do this without disturbing the birdhouse. What's it look like in the picture? Oh, it just looks like that. Okay, I can do that. Contains everything you need plus instructions. Neat. So glue the bottom panel to the truck. That must be this thing. Then how are we supposed to get the wheels in? Oh well, I'll just follow the directions. That's what I'm supposed to do. This glue is like... Why won't this glue come out? Jeez. Something's wrong with this glue. It's not coming out of the bottle. Is it sealed? Oh, that's great. Yeah, this glue appears to have sort of set inside the bottle. That's no good. Yeah, this glue is set inside the bottle. Air's gotten to it, so that's no good. I'm gonna have to use the rest of the one from the birdhouse on this, so that's always an interesting adventure. Probably used far, far too much glue there. It's not holding together very well. Glue and insert the truck bed into the routed portion on top of the truck body. That must be this bit, I guess. Okay. There's that. Thing's sort of sliding around on the glue. That's all sort of squeezing out the side. Oops. Oh well. Glue the cab in front of the truck bed. Wait, what? Oh, geez. So this is the cab, is it? Yeah, it says it on the picture. Wow, that's pretty pathetic. Okay, fine. We'll just do that then. There we go. So far, so good. And I'm guessing the next step would involve these axles and wheels in some way. There we go. Sort of try to do that a little bit. There we go. I did that. Then slide the axle into the routed hole, and then glue the second wheel. Oh, I see. So it's like a free fit there. So then they can sort of turn. Okay, cool. Wait, there's one more piece of wood. Where's that go? Oh, it's like a bumper or something. Okay. Wait, it doesn't say that. Does it? Oh, yeah, glue the bumper onto the truck. I missed that part. Whoops. I mean, I suppose if you're just getting into woodworking, this might be a decent thing. Let's put that bumper on it, and then that'll be done, and I'll let these set and see if either of them actually manage to set successfully or if they just kind of fall apart. There we go. We have now made a birdhouse and a truck. Yeah, the wheels actually go around on this one. That's nice. I'm not sure if you saw any of that, though, because, yeah. So there's the dollar store woodworking kits. Those are the only two I could find so far. I don't know if there's anything else, but at least they were sold out. And I'm stepping on this stupid measuring tape thing. It's breaking everywhere. So, yeah, I guess that's that for the dollar store Megaspecial or whatever it is. Okay, there's still one last thing I haven't done yet. You can tell I'm in my echoey kitchen here. Brand new LED lights that are blinding. It's this thing. I didn't try this out yet. I ran it for a minute and didn't do anything because there was no line on a paper. But now there's a paper and I'm about to put a line on if I can get this cap off without ruining my good shirt. Okay, so let's try it. Let's see if we can drive over that. There's a bit of a sharp curve in it, but hopefully it should be able to handle it. So I guess I just put it on the track and see what it does. That didn't work too good. Well, it's trying to do it. Come on. Oh, there we go. It's trying to do it a little bit. Yeah, that's kind of about what I would have expected for $5. Okay, I'll give it one last shot. I'll give it the benefit of the doubt. I guess the line, maybe the line I drew is a little bit thin according to the requirements. So, I also drew it a bit darker because this marker is completely dead now. Hi, Jason. Yeah, you can see where it's sort of faded out and gotten worse. So we're going to see if it can follow this. And if it can, then I will reverse my crappy grade. Yeah, it's got the infrared light sensors on it. You can see that there. That's how it works, the infrared sensors. So let's try this one. Oh, there we go. Works a little bit better. Oh, it's lost it. Oh, it tracked it again, sort of. Okay, can it handle this thing? Yes, it can. Okay. So as long as you have a decently thick line with a good quality marker, this thing will actually kind of work. It's just losing it now because the marker died at the end. Look at that. It followed the whole thing around that time. Will it track it again? No, it's lost it. Let's see if it can go around the other way. No, it can't go around the other way. That light spot's really messing with it. Try to guide it a little bit. It's not really working too well. There we go. It sort of worked. Okay, so if you draw a decently thick line, it will slowly traverse it. Come on, find it. No, no, it's hit the glass. I think I've confused it. Oh, I broke it.